Mark Zuckerberg, founder of Facebook and smoker of meats. His influence on the internet is a controversial one, and many, rightfully so, have major concerns about the kind of future he hopes to bring about with the help of tens of thousands of engineers all working on the metaverse. Whether we like it or not, the metaverse is upon us, but I think that with careful navigation of this uncharted territory, we could usher in an era of humanity that completely revolutionizes everything about our use of technology and our quality of life. Arguably, the most compelling part of this future incarnation of the internet is a technology called augmented reality. In this video, I want to discuss AR as well as some related technologies, talk about the risks and concerns, as well as the potential life-changing benefits this technology could bring us. A future where humanity blends completely with technology isn't a matter of if, but of when. Let's start with some definitions first, as things overlap a bit and can be confusing. There are a bunch of acronyms that you may have heard of, including XR, AR, VR, and MR. AR, or augmented reality, is a technology that involves adding visuals to your view of existing reality. The important distinction here is that reality is not occluded, but additional details like objects, screens, UI elements, or even people are added to the scene. VR, or virtual reality, on the other hand, is composed entirely of a virtual scene, which is inherently a lot more immersive and also requires you to disengage from base reality. Videos about VR are definitely coming, but if you absolutely can't wait, I recommend you check out my previous video about simulation theory, which has a decent amount of VR-related discussion. MR, or mixed reality, is a hybrid of AR and VR. MR is a pretty broad spectrum and covers a lot of different blends of AR and VR, but one of the more relevant versions for today's discussion is one where a real-time camera feed is overlaid with virtual objects and presented to the user. A potentially familiar example is Pokemon Go, where you can overlay virtual Pokemon on your phone's camera. A more advanced version of this is the pass-through mode on the Oculus Quest, now known as MetaQuest, which allows you to experience AR-like content in a low-resolution grayscale mode. There's a better, higher resolution color pass-through coming in the near future, and I'll be discussing this later in the video. Color pass-through will be a large step in the direction of true consumer-grade AR. Let's now talk about the metaverse. The metaverse is a massive buzzword right now, but it's certainly related to the topic of augmented reality. You can think of the metaverse as a natural extension of the World Wide Web. Today's web is a large network of interconnected servers and clients, and there's a constant trade-off between centralization and decentralization, and the metaverse will be no different. The metaverse is simply a label assigned to the overall ecosystem of interrelated services and experiences, primarily with a focus on blending the physical world with the real world. Certain aspects of these virtual worlds will persist, much like one's progression in an MMORPG or persistent universe. In fact, MMORPGs and games like Fortnite, Roblox, Minecraft, and Animal Crossing can all be considered metaverse experiences, and the companies behind those experiences are working hard behind the scenes to increase the level of immersion and impact and usher in the future of gaming. If you wanted a lot more information about these topics as well as a good primer on the recent MetaConnect 2021 presentation, I recommend you check out my friend Neuropod's recent video on the metaverse. After you finish my video, of course. I've linked it in the description below. I'm not going to bore you with the cliche use cases everyone talks about when it comes to AR, like medical imaging or manufacturing or navigation, because videos about those are a dime a dozen. Instead, I want to focus on use cases that have the potential to massively improve everyday users' daily lives. Let's start with what I think is conceptually one of the simplest use cases that will unlock a ton of value for large portions of the population: desktop replacement. I know that doesn't sound particularly exciting, and you may push back by arguing that lots of people don't even use a desktop PC, but I would argue that inaccessibility of the desktop form factor is precisely why a lot of people don't use them. They're large and often expensive, and there are many non-optional peripherals like keyboards, mice, and monitors. The ability to replace monitors with AR-based screens in particular would have a powerful effect on the ability to multitask and perform creative work, whether that's video editing, research, or programming. Once AR headsets fill most of our vision, you'll only be limited by the amount of compute you possess, which could be partially or fully offloaded to cloud rendering. Another powerful application of AR is in bringing the concept of character creation or customization elements into the real world. You could preview items of clothing on yourself before purchasing them simply by standing in front of a mirror and seeing the virtual clothes on your body. In fact, there were some recently leaked tutorial videos for Meta's upcoming MR headset showing precisely this sort of scenario. You could preview body modifications like muscle building or weight loss and gamify progress towards those goals much more easily. Another way that AR could benefit your shopping experience is with the ability to preview furniture or decorations in your home so you don't accidentally get a couch that's way too big for your living room like I did a few years ago. Whoops. While we're on the topic of home improvement, imagine if you never had to consciously plan cleaning, chores, or declutters, but instead relied on an AI assistant that sees your home through your headset and makes recommendations or even gamifies home improvement tasks. Take out the trash or do the dishes for a certain number of points, which you can incorporate into weekly goals or spend on a reward like fast food or a movie night. I'm not sure how engaging this sounds to other people, but this sort of gamification is deeply meaningful to me personally, and has helped me a ton with self-development. And this topic certainly deserves its own video at some point. AR also has the potential to streamline incoming notifications, cut through the noise, and only present the most meaningful information to you without distracting you from the rest of your life. We live in an age where we are consuming a never-ending stream of news, entertainment, and communication. And in addition to causing ADHD-like symptoms, these distractions impact our quality of life substantially. A carefully designed user experience built around mindfulness could help us combat things like engagement-based positive feedback loops that dominate social media today. Finally, AR has the potential to replace several of the other electronic devices we typically use in our everyday life, like phones, TVs, computers, and game consoles. Think of all the different things that phones have successfully replaced, at least for the most part. Flashlights, GPS devices, radios, calculators, mail, cameras, watches, compasses, alarm clocks, voice recorders, calendars, PDAs, MP3 players, TV remotes, and the ability to spell. The list of devices, processes, and distractions that AR devices could replace or mitigate will likely be just as profound, given enough time. All of these potential use cases for augmented reality are certainly exciting, but we're not quite there yet, and there are a number of challenges we must overcome. Let's first focus on some of the more abstract and ambiguous ones, and then we can talk about the more straightforward ones like hardware innovation. The biggest challenge outside of hardware and software, in my opinion, will be managing public perception of AR as a platform. Remember Google Glass and the immediate backlash it got because of privacy concerns? This sort of backlash is likely to continue with the next generation of AR headsets, and companies must proactively navigate this PR minefield by being privacy first. John Carmack repeatedly highlighted Meta's internal policy of not collecting camera data from Quest devices and treating privacy first as a primary directive for the company's metaverse initiative. Additionally, Ray-Ban Stories pushed a very privacy-oriented narrative during its marketing of the device. You may choose to doubt these promises, which is absolutely fair, but the risk of the truth around this topic leaking is so high that it's very likely, in my opinion, to actually be true. I guess my channel is aptly named, but I do try my very best to think things through carefully and exercise a healthy amount of skepticism. Please keep me accountable about this. At any rate, you only need to use your imagination to understand why users' camera data is extremely sensitive. But on the other hand, this data would be extremely useful for improving the reliability and feature set of the software controlling things like hand and face tracking and making the products more inclusive. Perhaps the best way to resolve this dilemma is to have a substantially large internal testing base, which Meta certainly will have, as Facebook Reality Labs is now 10,000 strong with another 10,000 or more on the way soon. Hopefully they'll have enough employees to properly dog food things without having to compromise the privacy of the rest of the user base. Additionally, ad personalization will be even more invasive than it is now, due to the fact that the number of modalities and the frequency of multimodal data collection will increase substantially. In the world of machine learning, modalities represent different types of information, like audio, video, metadata, and sensor data. Combining these modalities for training purposes is known as multimodal learning, and this sort of system is often very effective in machine learning models and has the potential to further increase the accuracy and creepiness factor of online advertisements. I think personalized ads will continue to become more sophisticated and invasive over time, and while they're extremely effective for marketing purposes and the ability of businesses to attract new customers, perhaps we need to focus on creating business models that sidestep this positive feedback loop entirely. Let's talk a bit about one of the challenges more specific to the metaverse, which is the risk of centralization. Centralization has the benefit of efficiency, both in networking terms and in development time, and it also provides an easy path for standardization and consensus, at least when it comes to internal organization. However, this often leads to poor global standardization and the potential for abuse, and it makes it hard for the end user to have complete ownership of their digital goods and data. Decentralization takes time and innovation, and breaking even on efficiency requires a certain threshold of network effect. The metaverse will be largely similar, both in terms of architecture as well as the trade-offs we'll have to make. We'll likely have a number of small, medium, and large companies, as well as individual creators and influencers, all vying for market share across a number of verticals, including hardware, software, e-commerce, entertainment, education, and so on. The large companies will have a distinct edge when it comes to some of the difficult hardware and software trade-offs we'll end up making. And over time, we can attempt to move the needle in the direction of decentralization, but it'll certainly be an uphill battle. Finally, I wanted to talk about the hardware and software challenges we're currently facing and discuss the general progression from what we have now to what we'll ideally have in the future. Hardware-wise, there are several variables that have to improve, namely things like optics, field of view, and form factor. Optics basically refers to the display technology and screen, and that's way too complicated and lengthy of a topic for this video, so I'll just defer to this really detailed article published in Nature, which I've linked in the description. The higher your field of view, the more screen real estate you have, and the more immersive the experience. But unfortunately, AR field of view in publicly available devices like the HoloLens is extremely limited when compared to what we have now in budget VR headsets like the Quest 2. For this reason, mixed reality with a VR headset and pass-through cameras is an obvious stopgap until AR displays further improve. In addition, hardware will have to continue to be miniaturized to minimize weight and maximize comfort. AR headsets will aspirationally be no bigger or heavier than a standard pair of glasses or shades, but we've certainly got a long road ahead of us. On the software side, there's already a ton of ongoing research and development in the field of AR, from phone apps like Pokemon Go and Pikmin Bloom, to camera filters on Snapchat, Instagram, and TikTok, to AR-based shopping experiences. On the metaverse side, there are several games with some strong metaverse-like characteristics, including the 2003 social multiplayer game Second Life, as well as some more recent games like Roblox, Fortnite, and Minecraft. Roblox and Minecraft have a high level of customization and scriptability, as well as some forms of decentralization and the beginnings of an economy. And Fortnite hosts live events for millions of viewers and tells an ongoing narrative through its progression of seasons. These experiences will only continue to mature and become more influential on our society over time. We have a lot of work ahead of us, and thousands of engineers are working on solving a myriad of problems. And it's only a matter of time before we realize the future that is equal parts utopian and dystopian. Which side will win out in the end? That's completely up to us, because we have the monumental task of writing our own future in real time. Let's make the best of it. That's it for this video. Subscribe if you're interested in more videos about futurism and tech. If you have a suggestion for a future topic, let me know in the comments, and go ahead and follow me on Twitter at FutureOptimist to participate in planning upcoming videos. Link in the description. I'll see you in the next one.